structure, then you have a transmission line. For that also you can run a math and you know what is the Z matrix or the Y matrix for the transmission line. So, with pure math also you can do de-embedding. So, the simulation tool allows you to do it by using pure mathematics. You do not need to do any experiment. But in real world what happens is there are a lot of other things which takes place around your circuit. So, that will not be captured in a simulation. I do not get you. Yeah, in a simulation you can actually take away everything and run, but you are not simulating a device, no, in a simulator. You are not simulating a device. So, it is basically comes down to how you are interfacing your device with the real world. So, probably I will just go back to one slide to explain. So, you see your device is here, but you are measuring here. Okay. So, how do you take away this intermediate stuff from your measurement? That is why we do de-embedding. You cannot directly measure here. You most of the cases you have no way of doing it. It does not give you an interface to measure directly on top of the device. In some cases it gives, but in other cases it does not. So, in that case you will need to make some additional structures to create an interface through which you can carry out your measurement. But these additional structures will also be measured when you are measuring, but you do not want that. You only want the response of the device itself. So, that is why you need to take the response of these additional structures out of your measurement. That is why we do de-embedding. Is it understood? Okay. So, the second one, as I was trying a bottom up approach rather than a top down, is essentially talks about MMIC design challenges and RF designer's perspective. So, when we try to make a system, I was talking about devices and their models. So, you can use discrete circuits using those devices and models of active as well as passive elements. But when you want more integration, smaller size, lesser weight, then you need to move towards integrated circuits. That is the way you can reduce size, weight, power consumption, etcetera, etcetera. So, in RF domain we can do it in two ways. One is RFIC and one is MMIC. RFIC is still let us say a bit exotic in the 60 gigahertz or 40 gigahertz plus range, though it is being done, but there are a lot of issues involved. So, they are very pretty ubiquitous in the lower frequency range, let us say up to C band, in some cases even X band. So, all your GPS receivers that you are having inside your cell phone is basically an RFIC, or your Bluetooth receiver that you are having in your cell phone is also an RFIC. But when you go into this kind of higher frequency 30, 40, 60 gigahertz, then there are issues with RFIC. So, we designers try to take a shortcut, and that shortcut is MMIC, because MMIC gives you a much better performance, though the penalty is that the integration level is much lower. Within the same size that you can build an MMIC, you can probably pack thousands of CMOS or transistor if you use a silicon process, but in an MMIC your number of devices that you can pack is pretty limited in the size that we generally talk about. So, this is the agenda: introduction, foundry and technology choices, very important, design flow, DRC is design rule check, PCM is process control monitoring and tiling, understanding stack up and component choices, case study. If time permits, maybe some of the activities that we do. So, these are your different microwave and millimeter wave circuits that we generally make. Waveguide, microwave integrated circuit, these are hybrid, like you have discrete components like inductor, resistor, then distributed component like this is a filter. These are probably amplifiers. Then you have MMIC where everything is put into one monolithic block. So, these are the technology choices that we have as a microwave engineer. So, what is it? It stands for monolithic microwave integrated circuit, and essentially the whole circuit is fabricated using a single mold of semiconductor material. All passive and active circuit elements are grown over it using lithography, masking and etching. This is true for all ICs basically as an insulating crystalline material as both dielectric and active layer, and this allows you to integrate active and passive devices, even logic and control devices on a single substrate. So, essentially we start with a semi insulating material like any other. In case of normal ICs or RFIC, we will start with silicon and then create an active layer. Here you will start with a gallium arsenide or a gallium nitride or probably a indium phosphide, which is a semi insulating material, and then create an active layer on top of it using some kind of process like molecular beam epitaxy or so. So, why? Size and weight reduction, cost reduction for medium to large scale production volumes. This is very important. Important in the sense that there is no going back once you have sent something to the foundry. So, let us say you have designed an MMIC, you have sent it to foundry, it has been fabricated, your design is wrong, you cannot do anything about it, that whole money goes waste. Okay. So, that is the catch. So, your design has to be right in the first instance, you will not have a second chance. That is the catch with MMIC. So, let us say you have something like this. Here you can go back and work back on it, you can change something, add something, do something, and then probably come up write the circuit if it is wrong. Here there is absolutely no chance. So, of course, high performance with low loss passive components and transmission lines, that again probably this is kind of 15 millimeter by 10 millimeter in size, whereas this is probably about 1 millimeter by 2.5 millimeter in size. So, as you can see, all the transmission lines, devices, etcetera are very, very small. So, as they go down in size, the associated parasitics also go down in size. So, we end up with components which behave more or less we want them to, rather than in other unintended way that we were seeing in the first lecture. So, that is one advantage that you gain when you use an MMIC over an normal microwave integrated circuit. So, enhanced reproducibility from uniform processing and integration of all parts of the circuit. It goes through an uniform process of fabrication. So, there is less variation between piece to piece when you are making it. Integration is very tight with very good process control. So, reliability is more, wider frequency bandwidth because your parasitics are less. Then design performance realized without several iteration. So, there is the catch, without several iteration you can do it, but if you require a iteration, it is normally very costly. So, I will give you an approximate idea about the cost. 150 nanometer gate pHEMT process, 6 inch wafer, first time when you are fabricating it, it will cost you about 45 lakhs. Second time it will be around 15 to 18 lakhs. So, in that 45 lakh you are going to get 2000 devices approximately, 2000 circuits. So, your design needs to be right in the very first time. So, what people do? Will they try with 45 lakhs and then see whether their things are working or not? That is generally do not what people do. They do something called, or what universities will do. Let us say you are in an university and you are working with MMICs. So, that kind of a budget might be prohibitive, to test what you have designed. So, they do something called shared mask. There are some limited runs for all foundries in which one wafer is shared between many parties. So, there the costs come down to some appreciable level, let us say some 3 lakh, 4 lakh, and you are going to get around 20 chips. So, per unit cost is higher, but the total cost is lower. So, using that shared mask method, one can establish the design. So, once the design is established, then you can go for whole wafer fabrication. Only catch in the shared mask thing is that no foundry will do it at your time. They will do it at their own time. All shared masks, there are timetables for foundries which they publish well ahead, and then you need to catch up with them. Like they will have a deadline for submitting your design, then it will come up in its own sweet time. So, you need to align your time along with the foundry time. Whereas, if you are doing it for a whole wafer, then the foundry is all yours. You can do it anytime. Applications. In general, you can use it for almost anything in RF, almost no limitations. So, switches, amplifiers, attenuators, phase shifters, mixers, frequency multipliers, voltage controlled oscillators, phase detectors. Commercial, these are basically components. So, from component you can go to multifunction, multifrequency. So, combine switch LNA PA on one chip or system on chip, where you can probably include the baseband IF and RF in a one single chip, and then for 4G, WiMAX, etcetera. Military, it is very highly used in phased array radars for making TR modules. So, I know some of you are working in TR modules. So, you probably are handling MMICs if you are working in a frequency high enough. 60 gigahertz short range communication link, millimetric wave radar system, electronic countermeasure, electronic countermeasure, FMCW radar. So, the applications are endless. So, what are the foundry and technology choices that one have when one is designing an MMIC? This is the very first thing that one need to do. There are a lot of foundries around the world, and they all have different processes available for any engineer to design their MMIC. So, this is the first thing one need to select. So, generally it engineering and foundry support is given from the foundry itself. It requires a very good clean room, and then additional clean rooms are used. Generally is epitaxial growth is done somewhere else and rest of the circuit is produced somewhere else, because epitaxial growth requires a very clean environment, maybe of the order of class 1. So, these are the most commonly used semiconductor material for MMICs. So, there are two things which I would probably like you to notice. One is the electron mobility and second is the frequency range. So, you have silicon, silicon germanium, silicon carbide, gallium arsenide, gallium nitride, indium phosphide, etcetera. So, as you can see that silicon, the mobility is pretty poor, it is not good at all, it is around 900 to 1100, whereas in gallium arsenide it is much higher, 5500 to 7000. So, that is why you are able to push this frequency range much higher than silicon. Silicon you are pretty limited, okay. Nowadays it is being pushed further high with the help of SiGe. Then in indium phosphide it is still higher than gallium arsenide, and probably you can push it up to 140 or so. As I answered somebody's question that if you are only looking at high frequency and nothing else, then this is probably the material of your choice. But the issue is that this is less mature than gallium arsenide, and the processes and technologies are still evolving. Whereas, silicon is the most mature process, you can almost get it right in the very first time. There will be very less uncertainty when you design using silicon. Gallium arsenide is good, but it is still less mature than silicon. But it is maturing very fast. So, it has become pretty reliable and predictable. So, application oriented MMICs, I have listed some of the applications and their frequency and the device choice. So, low noise amplifier up to 10 gigahertz, you can probably use a MESFET. Nowadays, everybody uses a HEMT. up to 100 gigahertz, it is a HEMT, which is ubiquitous choice, and beyond 100 gigahertz, it is still a HEMT, but an indium phosphide HEMT. Medium power, you can still use gallium arsenide. Higher power at higher frequency is gallium nitride. So, 30 gigahertz is kind of limit for gallium nitride. Whatever processes available world over, this is kind of limit for gallium nitride. 30 gigahertz, the gain of this is pretty low, gain of a GaN PMT is pretty low, at least whatever is available commercially. There are some of the foundries like Northrop Grumman, which is a defense foundry for US, where they have developed gallium nitride up to 100 gigahertz, but that is not available to us common people. And switches, mixed signal, you can, one can use a silicon germanium BiCMOS, VCO is HBT. So, these are some of the technology choices and device choices that you have. And this is kind of gives a frequency versus output power graph. So, this is same as the earlier table, so only put in a different way. So, this is important, this has changed a bit, this is an old graph. So, as I was telling that LDMOS is pretty ubiquitous for all base station. So, as I was telling that LDMOS is pretty ubiquitous for all base station work. So, you have this LDMOS as power amplifier, but their frequency range is pretty limited. Whereas, gallium arsenide you can make some kind of medium power stuff up to certain high frequency. Gallium nitride is sitting on the top, as you can see in the power profile, it is sitting on the top, but again the frequency is limited. Gallium arsenide goes higher in the frequency range. So, this gives in one nutshell what kind of power you are looking at and what kind of frequency you are looking at. From this graph, you can probably select the material with which you would like to make your MMIC. So, these are the commercial foundry services available all over the world. I have listed most of them, some of them I may be missing. So, gallium arsenide, you have UMS at France, BAE system, GCS is US, OMIC is France, TriQuint US, Skyworks US, WinSemi Taiwan. So, we ourselves work with UMS and WinSemi both, and I will show you some examples. Gallium nitride foundry, though lot of them are listed, but there are only 3 foundries right now which are commercially giving their technologies, it is open for common people. WinSemi now have started their own GaN. So, which is not listed here. Then UMS has also started their own GaN, and Cree is basically the top foundry for GaN. And why Cree is top foundry? Because almost everywhere where gallium nitride is being used, it is used on a layer of silicon carbide, it is never used on its own, because silicon carbide has got very high thermal conductivity. With gallium nitride, we are trying to push power, and for that we need a very efficient thermal conductor to take away heat very, very fast. So, silicon carbide is thermal conductivity is pretty high. So, that is why it is a choice of material on which gallium nitride is grown, and that silicon carbide is single handedly produced in the world over by Cree. So, whatever foundry is doing their gallium nitride on silicon carbide, we call it GaN on SiC, they are buying the silicon carbide wafer from Cree. That is a bottleneck as well, because Cree being a US company, there is a lot of restriction on who can use it, okay, because this is mostly used in strategic applications in defense and so. So, lot of restrictions are there. So, what people are trying is, they are trying to come up with gallium nitride on silicon. Efficiency is a bit less, but there is no restriction. So, some of them are developing it, like OMIC is developing gallium nitride on silicon. It is still not fully mature, but it is very close. So, in what way MMICs are fabricated? So, you have this boutique fab, it is analogous to a boutique, a dress material boutique. So, essentially they will do a low volume but high mix products. That means, the volume is pretty low, but it is such an exotic MMIC or such an exotic device, it is not readily available in the market. So, somebody comes up with a requirement, they will sit and design and then produce it in low volume and give it. They generally involve pretty high cost, and they also do it for their own. Like Agilent has got their own MMIC fab, which they use only for their own instruments. The instruments that they make, they use this their own fab only for that. They do not sell, they sell a very limited number of mimics. They sell, but a very, very limited number. They are not generally a mimic seller. Pure play means they do not have any design capability. They will only offer you fabrication, like IBM Sigi line or even Win Semiconductor. They do not give you any help in the design. They will only, whatever you design, they will fab. Fabless, opposite of pure play, just a group of mimic designers like us who design mimic and then they are fabricated elsewhere. Take example of Hittite, there are about 60 engineers, it is now bought over by Analog Devices. They do a, if I am not wrong, they do an annual sell of around 350-400 crores, okay. But they are only designers, they do not fabricate anything, they only sit in a room and design, that is all. So, these are some of the processes available. We will come to the design later. So, the processes available from some of the foundries. So, I will probably try to expand a few. Like when I am telling that this is a PH25, this means this is a PHEMT process. The active device is PHEMT and it has got a 250 nanometer gate. PH15 is same, a PHEMT process with a 150 nanometer gate. PH10 is a PHEMT process with a 100 nanometer gate. So, why does this gate size matters? Because the gate size determines your transit time, and the transit time determines what is your FT and FMAX, up to what frequency you can actually operate. So, the smaller is the gate, the higher is the frequency, the higher you can push the frequency envelope of your design. So, power process will add a P before the process. So, that means it is a power process, and if there is an X at the end, that means it is even high power. This they have now come up with, though it was marked red, but now it is open. So, these are some of the processes available. Similarly, there are processes from all foundries available. So, you see you have a plethora of choice, there is no dearth of choice. So, it is a very difficult task to figure out what is good for your application. That is the first thing one need to zero on. So, I have listed again only the processes that is available from UMS, all the different processes. So, as you can see that PH25, it has got a 250 nanometer gate length, and PH15 has got a 15 nanometer gate length. The frequency, cutoff frequency is 90 gigahertz here and 110 gigahertz here. Okay. So, can anybody give me the definition of FT? There are two frequencies that we generally do, one is FT and one is FMAX. Unity gain of what? It is unity current gain. Okay. FT is the frequency at which the current gain of your device is 1, and FMAX is the frequency at which the maximum available gain of your device is 1. So, these are the two things. Generally, FMAX will always be greater than FT, but it is normally below FT in which you would like to operate. So, these things needs to be kept in mind, like the voltages, the frequencies that you can use, and the kind of power that you want to push. Like this, as you can see in the PH25, you are limited with 250 milliwatt per millimeter of power, but if you go to PPH25, it is 700 milliwatt per millimeter. And if you go to PPH25X, it is 900 millimeter. So, depending upon whether you would like to use it for a low noise process, a medium power process or a high power process, you probably need to select one of these three. So these are all the things that one MMIC designer needs to keep in mind when you are selecting a particular process. I have listed the OMIC service likewise, Northrop Grumman. So the presentation will be available, and this data is openly available in the internet, so you can all go through it. So I will stop here probably, and we will break for lunch.